Ja, dear students, this is the last and final part of our discussion of interactive and collaborative visual analytics. We discussed already a couple of aspects, including synchronized and localized collaboration, which is the most natural type of cooperation. People are in the same room, they are physically close to each other, see each other and fully recognize others and work jointly together. We discussed interaction hardware, like in this example here, where large shared spaces are available and private spaces as well. I want to discuss in this last part two situations that differ from this situation discussed so far. First is distributed synchronized cooperation. That means people cooperate at the same time with each other, perhaps even under time pressure, but they are not physically co-located. Yeah, they are remote. They need some kind of video conferencing software in order to share information, visualizations, make annotations, and communicate with each other. That is the remote part, and the final part is about asynchronous cooperation. That means that people cooperate with each other that are not only not in the same space, but they work on something to different points in time. So that, of course, is a situation where many aspects of the, so to say, conventional cooperation do no longer hold. That means the group dynamics that arises when people work together at the same time is no longer available. But on the other hand, it provides more freedom when to work on something. Yeah, maybe if a certain geometric model is created, a city model, I first wait until some other participants have made their annotations and I can have a final look at them and use their input as starting point for my reasoning process and for my additions to the model. That could be a kind of asynchronous cooperation. Yeah. A few more remarks to distributed visual analytics or remote visual analytics. I see both terms and I just mentioned both of them because I could not decide which one is more typical. These are synonyms. So video conference software is needed. You know several examples of this. Zoom, Skype can also be used. There are professional variants of Skype. They differ in many aspects. Data security, of course, is one of them. TeamViewer is frequently used because it's not only a video conferencing software, but also a whole project management systems, so that you can at the same time manage milestones and other aspects of software projects. An essential feature of these systems is screen sharing. Yeah, that is definitely needed for a joint discussion on some artifacts in a visualization. Chat and voice functions, of course, are also essential. Yeah. So what should be shared for optimal efficiency? Yeah, there was a study of Balakrishnan et al. That discussed this for intelligence analysis. Yeah. So a lot of information is available that is related to persons that are suspected to have carried out a crime. And one question here was, should we really share all the information that is available to discuss it, or should we only share the information on the arguments that the individual analysts have found out? Yeah. So the work is distributed. Everyone deals with certain parts of the available information and writes down some arguments, including the assumptions. I mentioned cognitive biases in the last week, so that this becomes obvious, and these arguments are then shared in a video conferencing system. And it turns out that this is more effective, it leads to better results, and analysts explored more options. That means the possibilities they consider exhibit a larger diversity. So, and why I discussed this here in the framework of a visual analytics course, visualizations were included in this. Yeah. So here is basically a network drawn that relates figures that are essential in a crime analysis. Yeah. In red are two persons that are suspicious, and there are their major networks. The two suspicious persons have no direct contact, at least that was not found here, that's not represented in the data, but they are indirectly connected via some other persons. The thickness of the lines here indicates the intensity of the contacts. I'm not sure how this was measured. It could be the number of phone calls in a certain period of time, or other information that is available to objectively assess the intensity of contacts. Yeah. So that was a nice case study on distributed visual analytics. Another consequence was also, and that relates again to the social aspects of cooperation, the group dynamic aspects. It was considered as positive, at least here in this example and from this team, that every user was responsible for analyzing a certain part of the data herself. That creates a certain sense of being responsible for something, ownership, as it is often also called, and that was beneficial for motivating a really in-depth analysis. Yeah, each analysis was aware of the fact that there is not another person looking at the same data in the same intensity, so everyone really has responsibility. I want to mention a second example for distributed visual analytics, which I find quite convincing, yeah, as a use case, and that is disaster management. Imagine a large flooding, for example. Yeah. So in disaster management, decision making is really time critical. Yeah. The persons that are involved really under considerable time pressure to make decisions. They need to understand the urgency of certain aspects. So that is definitely a situation where synchronous cooperation is required. Yeah, asynchronous cooperation requires more time. That's not available here. Distributed visual analytics has the advantage that also persons can take part in this decision-making process that are not at the place of the disaster, which may be even difficult to reach, as you may have heard in the news from some disasters in recent times. Yeah, if a disaster is severe in the sense that railroads are destroyed, streets are destroyed, then it is difficult to reach this place. Yeah, but there may be video capturings that can be used for decision making. So it's really important here that all participants in this process have an awareness of the situation and have the same information available to make sure that they have the same basis when thinking about the urgency of certain measures. It's also an example where definitely cooperation is needed, cooperation of different, differently specialized persons. So, for example, there are some physicians that are specialized for such situations, emergency medicine. There are also professional experts called emergency responders for such decision making. These are examples of the people that you need to bring together there. So performance and network delays, of course, are quite critical. And the paper that I mentioned here describes carefully an algorithm to solve these problems, so-called group synchronization algorithm that works with timestamps and ensures that all participants have up-to-date information at the same time. Yeah. So these were my remarks on distributed visual analytics, where people cooperate, but they are not in the same physical room. Yeah, let me finally make a few remarks on asynchronous cooperation. That means the situation where people do not work together physically at the same place, and they are also in different periods of time when they work on visual information, visual analytics data. I mentioned already that this, of course, does not benefit from group dynamics. Yeah, this awareness of we as a team are together and work of a problem on a problem that's typically not there. But it has more freedom and enables to integrate persons that otherwise could just not take part because they are not all available at the same time. So there are a number of quite important examples of asynchronous cooperations that are quite successful. I mentioned deliberately Wikipedia first. Yeah, many authors contribute to articles on Wikipedia and make sure that the quality of these articles meet high quality standards. Yeah, there are reviewing procedures. Sources are checked whether they are really valid and reliable. And based on the success of Wikipedia, many derived projects were created. Some of them include also a lot of visual information, so cycling path wiki, for example, that needs geographic information. People can enter their cycling routes contribute further information with respect to the quality of the cycling path and other aspects that are essential when you plan such a trip. Yeah, open source software development is another example. Social media, of course, as well, and more in the realm of visual analytics is ManyEyes, a system where users can upload data and can share these data, and many persons then can contribute to an analysis of this kind of data. Yeah, what are essential elements for asynchronous cooperation in visual analytics? Annotation functions are needed, commenting. Yeah, someone starts a new thread or adds to an existing thread. Content may be added. And of course, it's possible in some systems and also desirable that you don't have to decide whether this is an asynchronous cooperation or a synchronous cooperation. You may also switch in a system that is actually intended for asynchronous cooperation to a synchronous mode, for example, via a chat function. Yeah, if somebody is available, then you can start a chat with her. The whole design should support motivation to contribute. Yeah, and that means, for example, that contributions need to be clearly visible. That gives me a certain sense of achievement if it is really clear how I have contributed to something. Yeah, let me briefly mention some systems and developments. I want to comment a bit on the Voyagers and Voyeur paper from Jeffrey Hurf, already from 2007. I also want to briefly comment on a paper from Klimke and Döllner. These are specialists for geographic data visualization, including 3D visualization related to geographic data. And in particular, they are experts for the visual exploration of 3D city models. Yeah, very large geometric models that contain a lot of information on buildings, on streets, and other information that may be essential not for touristic purpose, but more for urban planning, for example. Yeah. There is also other work on asynchronous cooperative visual analytics from Melanie Tori and colleagues and from Meha that I only want to briefly mention here and not further discussed so managing together the history of the exploration is an aspect that was emphasized by Melanie Torrey, and the paper from Meha is essentially in supporting the awareness through collaborative brushing and linking, and their system was applied to collaboratively analyze tabular data in an asynchronous manner. Yeah, here is an example from this Voyager paper from Jeffrey Herr and colleague. So a number of data sets were provided there, all related to some demographic information and how it changes over time. So here, for example, is data available on teachers. Yeah, teachers in various subjects. Yeah, you can explore this here. The visualization is related to all teachers over time. You could also exclude females or male teachers if you want to make an analysis for these subgroups. And yeah, then you get this information here. You see this sudden increase of the number of teachers after World War II. That was added here also as a remark by one user, yeah, that here is a rapid rise. And if you look, here is 1945. So it's a few years after World War II that this actually happened. Here another user entered, that was the introduction of required education. Yeah, so approximately in 1930 in the United States, it was mandatory and required that children go to school. It was not required before. You see that the influence on the number of teachers is rather low here. Yeah. So we don't see in relation the number of children, the population of the United States was growing in the whole 20th century. The number of teachers should at least grow in the same way as the population overall was growing. So that is not integrated here. And this visualization could be something that could also be added. Yeah. So this is joint sense making based on this data set. Yeah. A number of features were available. You could bookmark information visualizations, and you could share your bookmarks. Also a whole history which visualizations you have visited, and you can make this available, and that could be shared, yeah, in an asynchronous manner. Yeah, and let me briefly describe this system from Klimke and Döllner here. I mentioned already that their area is city models. Here it's a rather simplified city model, certainly not appropriate for tourist information and city marketing, but perhaps for some planning procedures, where there may be a joint discussion what should be constructed, where something should be built, what is the height of this building, how it relates to adjacent buildings, and so on. Yeah, so that is the realm of this system. Yeah, city models are considered, I use this term directly from this paper, as integration spaces for geodata of various sources. Typically, geographic data is available in various layers. So there could be a street layer or a public transport layer, or a network layer that relates to all kinds of electronic supply, water supply, and whatever. Yeah, for planning purposes, you definitely need experts from various areas, and yeah, that all is included here in this system. What I like in particular is this sketch-based editing. Yeah, for discussions, sketch-based editing is really a very natural mode of interaction. What I mean with this point here, many thoughts on efficient realization, that relates to the fact that there are actually quite large 3D models. And if these large 3D models should be made available For others, then of course rendering should be quite fast, so that the system incorporates level of detail concepts, view dependent rendering, and other aspects for rendering large 3D geometric models quite efficiently. Yeah, that's a very technical aspect of this, but it is essential for the success of such a system. Yeah, with this I want to switch to pair and group analytics, and we'll discuss some special modes of cooperation. I want to start with pair analytics, and I must admit that when I've read this paper many years before, I think in 2014, that was really quite inspiring to me and influenced me to think about similar strategies in our work as well. Pair analytics is heavily influenced itself by pair programming. Yeah, that is a software development strategy where two persons develop software together, and the major ingredient of pair programming is that one expert constantly explains a solution to another, and that forces this expert to verbalize why he did something in a certain manner, to explain the decisions, the pros and cons of different solutions, whether a certain subclass should be developed or not, whether something is connected to another class via a joint instance, for example. So fostering discussions about shortcomings, alternative solutions, and possible improvements. That is the major promise and potential of pair programming. It is not a manner to program something as fast as possible, but it is a strategy that puts a focus on the quality of the results. And back to visual analytics, here the idea of the authors was to improve the quality of visual analytics, the quality of findings, of hypotheses that are generating. A pair of users should cooperate. And they suggest that this pair could be any pair of experts, but very likely a pair that involves a domain expert, for example, an expert for financial analysis, and a computer science expert that knows the tool very well, that knows the involved analytic capabilities, the visualization capabilities, the interaction capabilities very well. And these two persons should intensively communicate on the data that they jointly analyze. The domain expert has some high-level ideas what she wants to analyze. The computer science expert can contribute how to map this intent to tasks, subtasks, and actual actions to be realized with the system. And if this pair works together for a longer time, not only for one session where they analyze one part of a data set, then they mutually understand each other better. And that means that the domain scientist more often has a good idea what the system actually can do and what it can do efficiently. And on the other hand, the computer scientist has a better idea of the intents of the domain scientist. So the computer scientist may suggest strategies how to analyze the data. Back to the discussion that we had so far, there is co-located cooperation. There could be also remote cooperation in the Balakrishnan paper that was applied to people that work together in one room. We realized this pair analytics strategy in a paper presented by Paul Klemm and others with remote experts. I was wrong a minute before. Balakrishnan also did remote cooperation. So we worked together with epidemiologists. These are specialists for analyzing large medical data, many thousand healthy volunteers, were asked a lot of questions, a lot of measurements were taken. We developed a system in order to analyze these data and to actually do this. We made joint sessions with the epidemiologists at the University of Greifswald, yeah, which is 400 kilometers away. It would be not very efficient if we had to travel every time when we want to make joint analysis. But we really try to follow this principle of pair analytics. Yeah. So why is this beneficial? The experts discuss with each other. Yeah. And that improves their mutual understanding. They have to verbalize what they want to do, what they think about it. Often an evaluation strategy for visual analytics systems is that you ask the analyst to think aloud when using your system. Why are you doing certain things in a certain sequence? What do you want to achieve with this? Are you satisfied with the system, with the analysis results, with the feedback of the system, and so on? Yeah. Honestly, these think aloud evaluations do not work very well. Why they do not work very well? If you have one analyst and ask this analyst to think aloud, that is very artificial. Yeah. Basically, you ask the analyst to talk to herself. And most people are not familiar with talking to themselves. They are familiar with talking to others. So if you have a pair analytic situation and you want to evaluate the system, then it's highly informative to just record and analyze this natural communication between the pair of experts. Yeah, that is quite helpful. Yeah, it's a kind of face-to-face communication facilitated by video conferencing, of course. So that's quite nice. So, and pair analytics, of course, can be extended to group analytics. So you have not only two users, but a little bit more, not too many. We discussed already that the effectiveness of a group decreases from a certain group size on. So we think of a small group of, let's say, 4 to 5 analysts. Yeah, for complex research questions, that may be really beneficial. I mentioned already our cooperation with epidemiologists. Epidemiology is an essential part of public health. Yeah, there is not only the medicine that's carried out in hospitals, for example, where people are critically ill and need to be urgently treated. Public health, in contrast, observes developments over time, risk factors for diseases over time, how infectious diseases spread, and they want to set up measures that improve the overall health of the population. For example, in case of an infectious disease, there are various measures that can be taken in order to limit the effects of this spreading. That is often not so severe in case of the general influenza season. It was, of course, much more severe in the situation of COVID-19. Yeah, so here's an example of such a co-located pair analytics situation in healthcare. Specialists for injury prevention cooperate with a computer science specialist to analyze injury data. What is injury data? Data related to accidents that took place. Yeah, and it's interesting from a public health perspective to observe over time what types of injuries occur, how often they occur, how this has changed over time, which age groups are affected. Yeah, and that can have consequences for certain measures. As an example related to this particular paper here, they collected injury data for children, and they wanted to understand whether there is a certain atypical frequency of certain injuries related to playgrounds. And if this would be the case, of course, if it turns out that some components of a playground are very insecure, then of course playground design needs to be adapted. Yeah. So, let me make finally a few remarks on evaluation with respect to interactive and cooperative visual analytics. I try to give you a feeling for the large variety of systems that is already available. So if you would come up in your master thesis, for example, with a new system, with new strategies for cooperation, one would ask you, and how do you know that what you have developed is not only new, but also better with respect to other systems, yeah, in comparison to other systems. So you need to systematically analyze your system and typically compare it, at least conceptually, but even better with a running system to other existing system. You need to validate your design choices, yeah. Of course, there are guidelines which you may use as inspiration. For example, how to present time-oriented data. But these guidelines do not, fully are not enough for all design decisions. Yeah, still you have certain degrees of freedom. So. Therefore, it is still a design task and not that you just have to follow something that is already clear. Yeah. And even if you follow guidelines as closely as you can for a particular application, sports analytics, for example, it is not clear that this is really the best way to do. So you need evaluations. Yeah. You want to understand how the system is actually used, how usable it is, that means how cumbersome the use of the system is, whether there are obstacles, and how the system contributes to something useful in the actual domain. Yeah, I mentioned here patient care and medical research, that would be for visual analytics in healthcare, but of course it could be related to another application area as well. Task-based experiments are very useful, so the pair of users or the group of users gets a certain task, and then you can observe and also measure how the group actually tackle the task, how they explore and analyze the data. That is predefined data, perhaps data from the internet or from a benchmark. You try to document this decision-making process, the conclusions that arise, try to validate even the quality of these occlusions. So these are essential aspects of evaluating cooperative visual analytics system. What is also recommended to capture is whether users trust the system. Yeah, and with this also the conclusions that they draw with this. In many cases, there is just one session, takes let's say an hour, where the data is analyzed. Users are not familiar with the system, so there is a learning curve while using the system, but you want to make conclusions for how it would be if the system is used routinely, yeah, and that's different than the situation when you still familiarize with the system. Yeah, what kind of usability analysis you can do here? You can use log protocols, that means whenever the user activates a function, you write something in a log protocol. Yeah, you enrich your software in such a way. There is a timestamp so that you know how long certain features were used. You can analyze how often they were used. You can also look for certain sequences. Yeah, is there something that users often used two functions alternatingly? Then this could be an opportunity to automize and optimize something. And you can record think aloud comments. You may remember my remarks on pair analytics, where thinking aloud is much more natural than if you only have a single user. Insight-based evaluation was recommended by Chris North, a quite influential papers. So a few users use your system typically for an extended period of time. Yeah, so that's more for long-term use, and long-term use is more realistic. So they employ data set and tasks that are relevant to them. Yeah, so they should decide what they want to analyze, otherwise they would not work for a longer time. on these data. And then the reasoning process is carefully documented. So users are asked to fill in something that's often called a diary of use. Yeah, in German, a Tagebuch, with notes and ideally also with annotated screenshots that you really can understand which visual representations they used for making their conclusions. Yeah. So, and why is it called insight-based evaluations? They should in particular explicitly record new insights, something that was surprising to them. And if there is a collection of insights, it's interesting to understand the relation between these insights, the significance and the implications. Yeah. Yeah, and that would be analyzed in your evaluation. In their specific example, the system was used for analyzing microarray experiments in genetics, very large amount of data. This amount of data is not only large, it's also complex, and it is also noisy, which makes it really difficult to evaluate and understand it. Yeah. One may also think of using contest data. So for example, the VAST conference, the yearly VAST conference, had VAST challenges, data sets that were made available for others to develop solutions and finally to compare them. Yeah. Text analytics, for example, or movement tracking of data of park visitors, that can be quite useful for evaluations. Yeah, let me summarize this whole part on cooperative and interactive visual analytics. I try to explain that analytic reasoning of complex data naturally is a cooperative process that different analysts can contribute, including experts for the visual analytics tool and subject matter experts or domain experts, as they are also called. One attractive strategy is pair analytics, and in some cases a pair of analysts is not enough, which extends this to group analytics. I try to make you aware at several parts of this video lecture that visual analytics system designed for cooperation involve social aspects, or as Jeffrey Herr phrases it, you design a social space when you design a tool for cooperative visual analytics. So aspects of communication, cooperation, motivation in a group setting are quite important and need to be considered, and need to be considered also in the evaluation, yeah, because there could be some effects that even with careful design you could not predict. When you are aware of this as a consequence of an evaluation, you need to adapt something. Cooperation can be realized in different manners: co-located and remote cooperation, synchronous and asynchronous cooperation. I spent most of the time discussing co-located and synchronized cooperation, including the consequences, the implications that has on the appropriate hardware, on the output side, that means the display, but also on the input side. Yeah, let me make a few remarks on the references that I used for preparing all this. I should have emphasized this paper a bit more, from Arias, Herandez, Castra and Green and Brian Fisher, Pair Analytics: Capturing Reasoning Processes in Collaborative Visual Analytics. What I have emphasized, and I think that's good, is this quite early paper. I would really say that's pioneering work on cooperative visual analytics towards a multi-analyst collaborative framework for visual analytics, presented at the best venue for this, from Brennan, Klaus Müller and others. It was a quite large author group that I have abbreviated here. I want to make you aware again of the paper from Petra Isenberg, Daniel Fischer and others, co-located collaborative visual analytics using a tabletop display. I showed many examples of this system. I used this to discuss also the evaluation. You may remember in der evaluation, they tried to infer certain collaboration styles. They showed over time how this developed for the different groups. They correlated this with the quality of the results that were achieved. So that is really a paper that provides a lot of insights. And you may also remember that I used this reference quite often, the science of interaction, and this relates to visual analytics, yeah, from Pike, John Stasko, Chang, and Carroll, a quite famous author list and a very popular paper as well. Yeah, with this, I want to thank you for your attention.